We'll go ahead with the panel discussion on the theme, the COVID and the warriors. I would like to introduce the moderator of the session, Dr. Shrihash Jahirda. He's an assistant professor in TN Medical College and Noir Hospital, Mumbai. He's doing his doctorate in occupational therapy right now, and he's PG teacher for neurosciences. He's recipient of IOTA's Young OT Achiever Award, and he's the course coordinator for IOTA's Fellowship in Advanced OT Program. Over to you, Shrihash.
Yes. 365 days of pandemic nearly, and we are celebrating the anniversary soon, and it has been a lifetime experience for most of us. And as now, today, in this panel session, we celebrate the victory of occupational therapy over the virus, which was unknown, unseen, and it just came in our lives. These three panelists today are just the representative of all the great OTs that have worked tirelessly and bravely in the field of pandemic and served the community at the large. Dr. Pratibha Vaidya Madam is our first panelist. She is the Honorable Treasurer of AIOTA. And for two consecutive sessions, she leads the Department of Occupational Therapy at Nair Hospital. She's PG teacher in developmental disabilities and a member of Board of Studies. She's been felicitated with Fellowship of Academic Council of OT and AIOTA Professional Excellence Award. And as we know that she's a merit holder in UG and PG. Madam, welcome, and we really congratulate for you being the one of the pioneer leaders who implemented the COVID programs in the municipal hospitals in Mumbai. We have with us the young and dynamic Dr. Abhinav Mishra, who has done his master's recently in neurosciences. He has a lot of degrees to his credit and has fortified his practice with a lot of certification, with a gold medal in neurosciences, and is now in charge of rehabilitation services at NSCI Dome, which is a 500-bedded jumbo COVID care center. He supervises and coordinates the rehab services, and he provides an acute care, group therapy, and post-COVID rehabilitation services along with pre-vocational evaluation. And our third and beautiful panelist, Dr. Marushka Barbosa, an extremely intelligent, clever, and a well-spoken person from Goa Medical College, a bachelor from Goa Medical College, Bamboling, and an employee state insurance hospital, Margoa therapist. She is an accomplished orator, authored a number of newspaper and magazine articles on creating awareness about OT, and has won awards at national level conferences. She is a strong advocate of mental health and LGBT community, having done her bachelor's thesis also on the same. We welcome you all three to this great scientific session. Yes, Vaidya Madam, first to come to you. Yes, how did you battle the academic and the clinical challenges during the pandemic? You had to face, as a head of the department, you had to face the two very major issues, like continuing the UG and PG education and also the clinical services that rendered. So how did you go about it?
To start with, I would really say that it was a battle, because you're asking the question in the form of battle. It was a battle on the academic front as well as the clinical front. So to talk about the academic front, our students were clueless about the immediate future. Their clinical work was deprived. There was no education. There was complete educational halt. And there was the dissertations of PG students were at stake, where they were in the midst of the dissertation. After a brainstorming effort from all of our teachers, we had decided to make a good program for the clinical front. And we came up with a three-tier program, which included educational programs with theoretical foundation, program for clinical-based scenario, and skill demonstration. And this helped them, the PG students, to remain in loop and ease. They were totally clueless of what is going to happen with their future. We didn't stop here, because along with PGs, we needed something to be done with the UG students also. And we immediately started with online classes on Zoom platform, which was a success. And even though it was not one-to-one connection, it was a success. We had to conduct exams, which were also conducted online. And the same thing was adopted by all the three colleges in Mumbai. So this was what we did in our academic section. Now, when you talk about clinical section, we were really in a verge of uncertainty. The OPDs of Nair Hospital turning into totally COVID-19 hospital, the all rest of the OPDs were at halt. We were not allowed to take any patients other than COVID patients in the hospital. Now, what was the role of occupational therapy in such circumstances? So this uncertainty again led us to a brainstorming effect, and we planned a meaningful program for these patients with mild and moderate COVID symptoms who were admitted in the setup. Now, for them, we were not allowed to go to the wards because we were lack of resources. Using a PPE, using an N95 mask by an occupational therapist, where the frontliners were falling short of it, was not a good suggestion. Hence, we planned a tele-rehab program for them, which were inclusive of stretching exercise and some music-related videos, which will keep our child COVID patients occupied. And these videos were helpful for the people who were bedridden to avoid the sequel of immobility. Then we did not stop here, and we continued along with patients. We saw that the frontliners and the faculty who are dealing with COVID patients had also developed some form of fatigue, some form of emotional instability. And then we went to do programs for wellness, relaxation, which you have already seen the presentations, and they were a success. Not stopping here, we later on clinical challenges we faced were with the post-COVID patients, and then we developed a program for post-COVID rehabilitation. So this is how I think we battled with the academic and clinical challenges with whatever resources we had in our hand.
So that was wonderful. Now, as a head of the department, she had no choice to but get into the board of pandemic. But for Abhinav Mishra, it was a made decision. From a roaring practice, private practice and a private organization, he had to opt as an in charge of a rehabilitation service at the COVID center. What made you do so?
So as you already mentioned that I was in a private setup. And an advanced rehab setup basically. But then somewhere when this COVID started, I wanted myself to be into it and help the people out there. So then I got this opportunity later and I took it up. So one main reason being the position which I hold here as in charge of rehabilitation department. That is one thing. And second was, how do I help people get better? So that is what definitely made me take up this challenge without a second thought.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. That self-realization that and that responsibility as a professional and as a human yourself, you involve yourself. And we have...
One more thing I would just like to add is that I wanted to actually show how
you involve yourself.
Yeah, as OT professional, how can I be helpful? And also evolving and developing evidences for OT in this pandemic situation.
Okay, that was great. Now I want to ask Marushka. Make a choice. And how did you feel or when did you don don the PPE for the very first time?
Hi, sir. Thank you for having me on this panel discussion. So I feel the first time when we donned the PPE, it was like almost as though I was in an oven. I was being baked in an oven. And with each layer that I was putting on, it felt like the temperature was rising another 10 degrees. But in addition to this, there was a slight amount of hesitation and this excitement about going and helping the patients who were waiting eagerly for us.
Okay. The hot oven, isn't it?
Totally hot oven.
And how did you adapt to this environment?
I'm telling you honestly, at the end of the session, we had puddles of sweat in our show covers and our skin was completely wrinkled. So we basically kept breathing regulation, which was very important for us, and taking breaks in between. So that was the only way to maintain our temperature regulation as such.
Yes. Changing regulation, changing guidelines, but one very important fact that we all as occupations that this hold is being occupied in something meaningful and something purposeful. Vaidya madam, how did TNMC OT COVID model evolve?
Now evolution, I have already spoken in my first answer, but here now I'm going to use something which I saw in the presentation, and those are the words of Dr. Oak. He said that you can retrieve, reform, restore, rehabilitate, and return. So we first retrieved. That was, we faced the challenges of commuting, of having fear of contacting the disease, what will happen to our near and dear ones, using the resources in a meaningful way, whatever was available with the municipal hospitals. And the greatest challenge was to keep the whole department safe and avoid getting contacted with the disease. So first we retrieved through our emotions by having brainstorming sessions. And through these brainstorming sessions, we reformed ourselves that yes, we can do it. And it's the OTIS who has to do everything best. Then we, after the reform, we restored ourselves by planning the programs which were continuing from the acute setup to post-COVID rehabilitation. So this is how we restored ourselves and we restored our patients to come back to their normalcy. So we started with breathing exercises, then wellness program for the faculty, then wellness program for the resident doctors, then relaxation program for the frontliners, and ultimately the post-COVID rehabilitation. Hence, we ultimately rehabilitated this patient and made them return to their normalcy into the community. This is how our program evolved.
Wonderful. And you spoke about the fear of contacting the disease and spreading it to others, I want to ask Marushka, how did you kind of toggle between the fear of contacting and spreading the infection at the same time serving the community?
So I feel the biggest fear was only about giving it to my family. I think me and my colleagues, we went into the mindset saying, you know, if it's bound to happen, it's going to happen. So the biggest fear for us was just about giving it to our family members back home. So over there, as soon as we would go home, we would isolate ourselves, you know, keep ourselves away from the family. We never really had the mindset of, you know, maybe we might get it ourselves. We were prepared mentally, like our faculty, the dean of us, he sent us with that mentality saying that, you know, if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. You take your appropriate precautions.
Okay. And with that, I want to ask Vaidya madam, was there any oh my God moment?
Yes. Oh my God moments I can describe. First is when the Nair Hospital was completely converted into a COVID hospital. This led us to a shock, dilemma, uncertainty, role or identity crisis. So that was really a oh my God situation which we came through, and we are out of it and we are well settled now. The second moment, though it's a personal front, I was the first one to get the infection of COVID-19. I was positive after a period of 3 months, which took us to settle. And this was a real emotional turmoil in the department, which led to a lot of confusion. We had to inform the authorities because that was the time when a lot of precautions had to be taken. Authorities had to sanitize our department, and each one of in the department had to quarantine themselves in their house. And lucky enough to know tell that nobody else got it. So I'm proud of it. At least I could save my staff from the infection.
That was a great responsible behavior that you actually implemented there. Coming to Abhinav, lack of evidences and, you know, changing guidelines all the time here and there. Okay. How did you formulate the program in spite of all these drawbacks?
I joined back. The center came up actually in April when the pandemic started, and I joined in October. So when I joined, the department was already running. So then I just went and I saw what is going on, and then I went on to different websites and papers, journals, but I couldn't find good evidences available for the same. So then I decided to go symptom wise. So when I went symptom wise, I could find a lot of things which were evidence based, and that is how we developed a program for each and every patient. And then we grouped them actually. In our setup, we have grouped patients like asymptomatic in one group, then patients who are oxygenated in one ward, then another is patients with comorbidity. So that is how it helps us to formulate a program for a particular ward. So if you go to see the oxygenated patients, we treat one-to-one, and then we give them individualized program. For comorbidity patients, we treat two patients or three patients at a time, monitoring their vitals. And asymptomatics are really good, a treat to us to treat. And that is, so we take them in a larger group. We do lot of recreational activities with them because there is a lot of scope to work with them. So right now when I'm speaking here, somebody back there from my team is taking a Garba session with them right now. That is how it goes. And in a similar way, we have programmed for our post-COVID rehab OPD as well.
Oh, that was really nice. And you can see some visuals of the program that are running in NSCI Dome. And one, let me come to Marushka. Marushka is also working in an acute setup, and you must have also worked on a similar lines. Can you give a gist of what you did at Goa Hospital?
So over there, we were basically divided. The hospital was divided into the ICU, ITU. And then we had third, fourth, fifth floors, which were of the less symptomatic patients. So what we would do is we would have to see all the five floors, including the ICU and ITU patients. So we would start off with the ICU patients initially, position them, the patients who required DVT stockings, compression stockings, we would give them that. Basic activities of daily living, which they could do in supine, like just retrain them. In addition to counseling both the patient as well as the caregivers, was done in the ICU and ITU setups. These were the more critical, more serious patients. In the ITU, it was more of respiratory training initially for them. Once we moved on to the higher floors, we were treating patients symptomatically. Like, for example, if we had a stroke patient, we would be giving him activities relating to the stroke in addition to pulmonary endurance building activities, and also psychologically uplifting them, preparing them back to go back to the society, and telling them how they should be maintaining their respiratory endurance, their work simplification techniques for them once they go back home.
So combining a lot of strategies and lot of theories and lot of practices.
Stroke patient, we will be giving him activities relating to the stroke in addition to
OT philosophy into the practice in this novel scenario. Abhinav?
Yeah.
How did you translate
OT
philosophy into the practice in this novel scenario?
So the base, the core of OT, as you said, is being occupied. So we considered the desires of the client. So I would like to give you an example. If you can just show the slide, please. So we had recently, we have had an admission. She's, if you can see that female, yeah, she's a retired physiotherapist from Nair Hospital only. So she was in a bad situation, and this is our oxygenated ward. You can see the oxygen cylinders kept there. So she was on she without oxygen, she maintained 85% of SpO2 around, but with oxygen it was around 92. So and she was anxious, and she is also a case of depression. So social withdrawal, she was socially withdrawn. and hardly doing her basic ADLs. So we tried to convince her to do some exercises for at least 2 days, but she was not interested. Then what I did was I asked her, can you show our patients some breathing exercises which will help them build up their endurance? So then she quickly got convinced with that. And that is how we incorporated occupational therapy for a physiotherapist to do breathing exercises. This helped her, raised her SpO2, and this helped other patients as well. So now she's herself taking sessions three times a day for all the patients there when we are not there.
So implementing and then empowering the patients to take care of themselves and involving them in the whole process.
Correct.
That is what is called as a client-centered occupational therapy. And I congratulate you for implementing such a client-centered process at your dome. Marushka, one moment that you felt during this whole care that it was all worth it. So implementing...
There was this one patient.
Marushka, you are logging on from two different, I think. Please...
Yeah, 1 second, sir. You're done, sir? It's fine.
Yeah.
So there was this pretty old man whom we were seeing when we were in the ICU. And he was very critical. Like, we didn't have much hopes of him, you know, surviving. But then we spoke to him, we counseled him, gave him some activities, and he shifted out from the ICU to the ITU. And after a few weeks, we shifted, our shifts changed. So we did not see him. So we were not sure whether he survived it or whether he had passed on. A few days later, we see his son in the parking garage, and he comes up to us and he's like, doctor, you remember this patient? We were like, yeah. He's like, he's back home and he's happy and he keeps taking your names and he keeps telling us how you helped him get out of it, how you spoke to him and how you gave him strategies to continue back, like living like normally. So I think that was where it, you know, made the difference. Like, that way there are a lot of stories, but this was the one patient who actually, like, you know, he came back and he just remembered what we did for him. So this was it, sir.
While acting as a media of change in somebody's life during this COVID, there must be a situation which have been like bearing the brunt of being unnoticed. Abhinav, can you tell any incidents? Like, where did you feel that being a warrior is actually, it's a tough task?
So if you actually ask me what brunt did you bear, I would say actually I did not. The only thing is I missed my ghar ka khana, which I've not been I've not been home since past like 4 months or 5 months. That's the only thing I would say I'm sorry for.
So what incentive did you get?
I got a good position, and with position comes good money.
So I want to make a point here, though it was taken in a lighter sense, but yes, there were a lot of opportunities created in these domes for occupational therapists to work, and they were actually remunerated well for their services, and they were recognized for their services. With that, I want to ask Pratibha Vaidya Madam, how did all this program change the perception of occupational therapy department in the entire hospital?
Just because we had planned the programs for the warriors and they were on the battlefield, we thought of becoming their weapons, which was a very, very nice thing, because they too faced apprehension, fear, not meeting their near and dear ones, staying away from home. And this led to their own health issues of fatigue. They too went into anxiety and depression. So our programs helped them to relieve their stress, and they were relaxed, much more relaxed when they were in the acute phase or even in the initial stages of the pandemic. This made them more positive, gave them more positive attitude towards their work field. They could work longer with the patients, though they were allowed to work for 6 hours in PPE. But their positive attitude, their increased self-confidence led them to relieve their stress, and they were less fatigable. This was a positive response which we got from our other professionals. So this, with this positive attitude and the response which we got and the zeal they had to perform the same relaxation techniques at home also was really satisfying for us. So this gave us a self-satisfying effect. And it is really overwhelming to help the warriors when they were really fighting with the COVID patients in the initial stages of the battle.
Marushka, if I have to ask you, how did this pandemic change you as a person?
I think it just made me appreciate life a lot more. It clearly opened my eyes. And one thing I realized was the importance of this non-verbal communication, what we use. So when we're under the mask, when we're in the PPE, you really miss out on that smile, that comforting, you know, hand, the pat on the back and all. So I realized that once this pandemic ebbs over, we should keep that into account more often, this importance of non-verbal communication, especially with the patients, because they rely a lot on, you know, when you're giving them a comforting smile, when you're, you know, approaching them in a warm manner, they respond well to you. So I think that is one thing I learned as a professional, and that's what's changed in me when I react with patients now as well.
Thank you. Abhinav, I want to come to you and ask, working in an NSCI dome, you must be surrounded by other professionals. How do you have this the association or the transdisciplinary approach, and how do you work and kind of coordinate all the services? A quick one.
So it's basically not on referencing basis. We work in conjunction with each other. Whosoever patient is there, we treat them, and it's more like working together rather than hierarchical model. We don't work on hierarchical model. We communicate with each other. If today I find a patient who I find might be having difficulty later, so I inform the other in charge fellow of mine, and he will take care of the patient from the medical point of view. And in a similar way, if they find something difficult with the patient and they are not able to manage medically, they will refer the patient. They will tell us that, go, please see this patient if you can help in some other.
Yes. And now that we have actually reaching the anniversary of Corona in the country, if Vaidya Madam, I have to ask you, how would you describe in one word the whole experience?
Oh, overwhelming. It is overwhelming, which has made us physically and psychologically tough. And it has united all of us in our department so well. And we have used our talents, creativity, our OCD features in planning all these programs. And this has helped us right now also, because we are coming back to non-COVID state now. We are partly COVID, partly non-COVID. So we have integrated so well into, and so easily we are looking, having no fear of looking at them even without a facial. We are with one mask of N95 and nicely seeing the patients with all conditions of hand, all conditions of neuro and orthopedics. So that is what has made us really tough.
Abhinav, if I have to ask you one word that would describe...
made us to work beyond our repertoire. We have stretched beyond.
Yeah. So work beyond your repertoire. And yes, if you have to describe, Abhinav.
It is exciting, I'll tell you. It is exciting. Every day you have to see something new coming up. It is definitely exciting. I wait for the next day. What is going to happen?
Marushka?
I would just say life-changing, sir. Like being just 22 and having to experience all of this at such a young age. So it was definitely life-changing for me being to go through all of these hardships to deal with this amount of, you know, mental changes. So definitely life-changing. But it was a valuable experience. Like definitely would want to continue working with such patients again?
If I want to put it as in conclusion, that I think we all have been now to, entered a history, and we are all the historians who have played this pandemic so well. Not just these three, but all of us within us, the warriors within us, those who were felicitated, volunteered yesterday, and those who are still bravely facing each day at their clinics, at their hospitals, and as an occupational therapist, and as a human being, we all have learned one thing, that is, life is precious. Being we all have been now terminal, and that we have to get a support, and we need to prove ourselves as metal and get change of perception about our therapy in amidst the other professionals. And most importantly, we have to hold on our moral responsibility towards the community as the very biggest tool of occupation that we have. Thank you so much for being the wonderful panelist. Thank you for that wonderful life-changing situation that you have faced and that you have given a new meaning to others. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. We thank Dr. Pratibha Vaidya Madam. We thank Abhinav Mishra. And we thank Marushka and the entire scientific committee, the organizing committee, Dr. Jyotika Bijlani, and definitely President Sir, Vice President Sir. And my special thanks to Sunny Joseph Sir, because he's provided with this wonderful place to conduct this. Thank you so much.